And by doing the streets with the building numbers, we're able to actually provide an address for each building, which will facilitate mailing as well. So this proposal, we basically got one primary corridor, which is called Brooklyn Navy Yard Way. And then we have a number of sequentially numbered drives. So first drive, second drive, third drive, which goes counterclockwise, which gives an intuitive sense of navigation to the site. Off of those streets, we've clustered buildings by number, 0 to 50, 50 to 100, 100 to 200, 300. This also forms the same counterclockwise sequence. And the numbers were also optimized to retain some key existing buildings, for example, building 77, which fits within the 50 to 60 to 100 cluster. So how that works out, we worked closely with the Brooklyn Topo Office to ensure that we're satisfying the best practices of addressing in terms of consistency of odd and even to the north and south and to the east-west. And they've reviewed this and are in support of this grant scheme. On the gates, and we touched on this last time, they are being renamed, or proposed to be renamed, so as to better connect with the surrounding context that we're going to use for navigational purposes. So we've got the Williamsburg Gate, Clinton Hill, Fort Greene, and Depot. On a placemaking standpoint, this is a large campus, and the need to kind of break that up into digestible pieces, we're using the idea of a district described through color to help with that mostly pedestrian scale orientation. So each of these districts represents about 10-minute walking radius. They will not be named because the name is not a critical part in the navigational system, but the color you will see featured on more of the placemaking devices. So color, this is an important part of the work to inform that district approach. We are taking colors from the existing Brooklyn Navy Yard brand identity, which features three primary colors. And the three are used to describe this district, but the outside edge is described mostly neutral to the exterior face with features of the prime color, the orange color. These colors were tested against the variety of materials, predominantly brick and metal. How they feature across a range of sign types, and we'll go through these in greater detail, is really oriented to the building number IDs, both projecting and primary entrances. The color will be used for high contrast visibility, and then also in placemaking devices like gate fence line service entrances, some are more primary visitor-oriented and tenant-oriented entrances. For those primary entrances, we see the need to kind of make those visually more prominent. So here you see a sort of feature entrance treatment, which shows larger cutout letters, which are attached to a simple pin connection, and they also become a photo of the district. At a smaller scale, once you've arrived at the entrance, there's a variety of information that needs to be communicated, confirming the building number, but then also adding additional information, whether it be service by nature, or if there are certain tenants that need to be communicated on the onset. For service entrances, it's important to manage freight access, and that we serve concepts in a variety of conditions. Sometimes they need to be larger, depending on the scale of the entrance. For pedestrian directional signage, there's this family of finger post signs. They show you key destinations or landmarks like the shuttle stop for the ferry. This is also paired with street IDs, which take on a more conventional New York City vocabulary. And we've looked at the variety of mounting conditions to those street ID signs and how they're combined in one finger post system. On the vehicular-oriented signs, this takes on more the identity of the Brooklyn Navy Yard, as this will be a kind of key entry for trucks and for visitors and tenants arriving by car. There is a range of conditions that it has to integrate in. Sometimes there is room for two posts, sometimes there isn't. So we're looking at a range of types as a result. The shuttle, this takes into account the existing shuttle structure within the yard. There's a need for that longer range visibility with this cube icon, and then clarifying what the shuttle stop is with a sort of more integrated discrete band sign. We're taking a look at improving the graphics of the shuttle maps. And here you can see this mock-up on the shuttle stop today. There will also be a shuttle for the interim providing access to the near East River Ferry to the Flushing Gate. And we are keeping consistent with the shuttle ID here and then finger post to the ferry. For more baseline mobility-related signs, from parking to bike parking, accessibility, charging, we include a simple set of post signs. So tenant signage guidelines is an ongoing piece of work. We recognize that there's a history of more visible tenants, whether it be Admiral's Row, Wegmans, or Building 77, where they've got a different set of considerations for communicating the tenant. In terms of developing a system that would speak to the size or the recommended use of color material, that work is ongoing, and we'll have an opportunity to show that when it develops. On ongoing work. There, as you can see, this is a small area here, just north of Cumberland Gate. There are many building-related signs that will need to be incorporated, particularly because of the number of entrances around each building. So we've gone through and surveyed close to 500-600 entrances, both to confirm the nature of the entrances, which weren't signs, what they have to communicate. So this is ongoing work for the board, and will inform a kind of content schedule, both in terms of placement, sign type, and the content that needs to be featured. So next steps, with your feedback, I'm going to continue to develop the typologies through fabrication drawings, ongoing work to do detailed sign placement, as just described, develop those tenant signage guidelines, and integrate this work with the gates. That's our last slide.
Is there just too much kind of over indexing on these systems, and is it because also the you know, the kind of fencing, you know, that's a sort of symbol system that, again, it's, you know, it's not externally meaningful, but it's kind of accentuating these districts. You know, the districts make sense as the, you know, the cognitive device, but, you know, creating a sort of like branding for districts, you know, associated with the color and then with the shape. I think it's, you know, it's not really, to me, emphasizing like a sense of place, but more this kind of like cognitive system to emphasize. So, and I think it, you know, we're trying to, you know, create this site that's kind of, you know, accessible, memorable, has to do with the kind of like history of the Navy Yard and like builds on that kind of, you know, historical equity. The cognitive system at a certain point is, you know, emphasis just becomes, I think, disconnected from that and almost like arbitrary.
I think this really is the big debate, the structure and how the concept is supporting that. I mean, we've worked through this for a while, and, you know, even the idea of naming the districts, whether that was helpful or it created unuseful information, because people are only using the numbers and the streets to get where they need to go. So, in other words, you're not saying, first go to, you know, Red District, and then go to the street, and then go to the building. It's all working off the building number, so that's simple, and we wouldn't want to complicate that. And so the idea of naming the district kind of fell off. But the need to break up, I mean, this is like the size of some neighborhoods, right? So the need to break it up in some way was really important. Both the long-term growth of the Navy Yard, but even in terms of the near-term issues navigating. And, you know, the place already, in a way, are already, they each have a unique character. As you described, this isn't super developed. It does feel more industrial, much more horizontal. Here, we've been referring to it as a historic core because it has a much finer grain, lower brick buildings mostly. Here, you've got more height, a mix of metal, concrete, brick, with views to the cranes, the shipyards. So we're really seeing this as kind of supporting or amplifying existing character of these districts. So in no way are we trying to say, you know, we're able to rebrand just through color the existing character of the place. It's more just how can we begin to, you know, visually break this up so that people could start using this as a visual marker. Okay, well, I'll meet you, you know, in the blue district, or I'll meet you, my sign's blue, you can look for the blue one. Because those visual cues will be helpful given the scale and navigational challenges facing the Red today.
Yeah, I mean, I think when you say like a physical material character of the site, I mean, I think that's a great thing to draw upon, but, you know, something is industrial, that doesn't mean that it's scaled out, for example, or something that's historical doesn't mean that it's blue. Mm-hmm. And so that's what I mean when I think like the, you know, cognitive device is become separated from, you know, the act. So it's no longer a place-taking device, it's just a kind of internal system. So it's not externally meaningful. Does that make sense?
And also, like, we don't know the ultimate uses of all these places.
Yeah.
So then what if, you know, does it make sense for a certain section to be red anymore at some point? So would it make it easier to have a consistent branding of numbers and just overall color, and then once these those design, how does the street design reinforce this signage? It feels a little back, I'm not saying backwards, but cart before the horse. I mean, wouldn't we need to, I need to know that I'm on a street, you know, that I'm on a street that's designed in a particular way that has, I guess there's curves, and that's what's a little confusing when you're there, right? Because I need to be able to find this Broadway of Manhattan. I need to be able to find the Navy Yard way if it's going to help lead me somewhere,
know, for me to see the colored district, it makes sense on the map. But then I'm not sure that it needs to, you know, I don't think it actually needs to be emphasized in, like, you know, structure, really, as much as it is being implied here. And I think maybe, like, an orange brown color makes sense as something that kind of, like, ties all the sites together can work. And maybe, you know, to speak back to the map, you have, like, some blue or gray or yellow accent. But to kind of, you know, impose that on the landscape, you know, the gigantic site, you know, I think I, again, I mean, I said this earlier, I think it's a big move to try and expanding the system that, you know, doesn't really have external meaning in terms of, you know, placemaking, symbolism, even in fact, brand. It's differentiating, but that's all it's doing. It's just purely functional.
You mentioned that we now have addresses. Can you elaborate on that?
Yep, so, and this, comments as well. So in terms, currently, mail is delivered centrally to one building, because it's one address, so it's in the yard, and then it's distributed within the yard. By renumbering and tying these numbers to these streets, these new streets, it will allow each tenant to have a dedicated address, therefore they can get direct deliveries.
Oh, so that there's
still
the same.
Some of them are the same, right?
Some of them
would be the same. The address and street address would still not be the same.
At the building number, it would. So the building number would now be their new address.
But the number, and not 17-1.
Pardon me?
That building number is the address, or is it a number on a street?
So it's a number on a street, and it depends on where it falls in here, these lines. So 77, for example, is off of Napier Way, so it would be 77 Napier Way. Now,
79.
Yeah, so 79 would be off of 5th Drive.
So let me jump in one second. So to the extent possible, we're trying to get everybody access to Napier Way, but the way that the toll clauses work is that you actually have to make your major entrance to a building must be on the street. And therefore, we had to create this fine, so hopefully we can enable it so those buildings have main doors on the street. So that's why we then came up with the 4th Drive, 2nd Drive, 3rd Drive, so that, because not all buildings are along the street, and you can budget. So that let us budget some, but not all. So we created the 4th Drive, 2nd Drive to capture all the other buildings that are not along the Napier Way. It gets very complicated with the local office. And the other reason why we had to rename the streets inside the yard is that many of the existing streets in the yard are already located outside the yard in Brooklyn. You can't use the street that's already been used somewhere in the borough. So we had to basically, we would have been able to keep maybe one or two of our street names, but we otherwise would have had to change all of them. So we decided just to try and come up with a system where it's just consistent and it is intuitive about how to get along.
So if you have this yardway G6 or EF or whatever all this is, that's the,
it's going to change the number.
You're going to change
the letters.
Those are, I'm just zooming in on that map.
So that map is slightly out of date in terms of the actual navigational content. That's really just more for graphics. This map, because I see you're on the last
slide. Oh, I'm on a different one.
So just because there's been many iterations as to allow for the kind of topo compliant version, which you see here. So that's just out of date.
But I was trying to put it together with your symbol idea of the big cranes and everything. So try to understand how it all works together, the naming, the numbers, the streets, the symbols. Because I'm going to go to the map, I'll say that's probably.
Absolutely.
You know, right?
going. And so I thought that the comment where we made about the extent to which the colors relate to the fabric of the streetscape is interesting. And, you know, I might follow a rail line, you know, or I might follow the cobblestones, or I've got high heels on, so I'm going for the concrete. Whatever it is. So I think it would be interesting to just test your colors or something, because you've already talked about the architecture, the materiality of the architecture. I think it'd be interesting to look at the materiality of the streets, and are they curved, are they curveless, and where are they going, if you can predict, or which ones are definitely truck routes or whatever. That might help. I think that for me personally, the idea that you, and I'm not sure you really meant this, but if you did paint the door frame, not that. That is, I mean, it's one thing for the color of the sign, but the idea that you would actually then go back on, that idea of painting a door frame in a historic building or even a contemporary building, seems way over the top. If you're still lost, something's totally wrong here.
It also does not look.
It doesn't. It looks horrible.
Yeah,
I mean,
it's
just
real. It's like the graphic design is taking over. And
the architecture and
number is enough. Once I get to the number, I think I'm there.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
I'm there. I got the number. I'm there. You know.
And
I don't need to know any blue, really.
The perpendicular sign versus the number.
Yeah.
Yes. So what's the relationship of that, which is a great idea because you can see it if you go down, relative to the door?
So this, every building gets one of these.
One?
One or multiple. It could be on a corner if you need to see it, because it's meant to be seen on the approach,
right,
either pedestrian or vehicular.
This place replaces the circular ones. You
correct.
Come out. They're blue with a number.
So they're sort of got a brown edge, and they're this. Yeah. These, because each building has multiple entrances. In some cases, they have 12 entrances, and only one of them is really the kind of primary tenant entrance and visitor entrance. So this more of a sort of feature building ID is to clarify that that's the prime entrance.
Which, so the color 92 tells me that if I were a visitor or a tenant,
that this is the main,
that's where I would go.
Yeah. There are other, you know.
And then you've got those other signs,
yes,
for the support.
More detailed support. Yeah.
Right, which is, I think, totally fine. And that hierarchy seems to me fine.
One thing is, on the perpendicular signs, I want to add, when we did the previous wayfinding, we found that we weren't always able, ideally, you would just have that near your front door, and then that way you go to the entrance. But not all of our buildings work that way. So this was just another cue, because you're not always going to get that in the same location.
No, I understand some buildings may actually be 200 feet long.
Yes.
And so this is at the intersection, and then you've still got
to
find the door.
Find the door
100 feet later. So
yeah.
I appreciate. I mean, that's how we navigate the city. We come to an intersection and whatever. So, I mean, I think that's totally fine. I think what we're all sort of saying is that there's maybe a bit, it's a bit much right now, and it needs to get pulled back. Different people have said different things about what this thing.
Well, another one, too. Oh, sorry. Another aspect of this, too, is that the totem also has the name of the building on top of it, and so it's a little bit unclear, you know, how those things, so there's
so
a
these,
totem.
Sorry, these are really a placeholder. They're meant to call any sort of primary landmarks of the area, so if it's in front of Building 77 at the gate, you would say Building 77. If it's on, you know, Fifth Drive, you would say Fifth Drive. And so there is a whole level, and that's the spreadsheet and the location of kind of indexing where signs need to be, what the content needs to say,
have the building, the primary building sign. You know, you have the totem, you know, you have the blade signage or projecting signage, and then you have the kind of, you know, thing around the door, and you have like a detailed signage, like the hierarchy just feels loose and not very clear. It's kind of like it's, you know, you could eliminate at least two of those things, I think.
Yeah. So
or,
we have it, we're like really far behind schedule.
Yeah.
I think that there's a lot of good feedback here. Yes.
Oh,
okay.
Sorry, go ahead.
Can we go back to slide 13? Sorry, because there were things that we wanted to say.
Okay.
It's really odd that Admiral's Row, which we know is no longer there, is not part of the blue section. It's really odd that the shipyard is not part of the yellow section.
Right.
And if I were actually trying to navigate it, and I found myself in the middle of the orange section, and I couldn't, it is an entire campus, I think, including Cyber Studios, should be included in the campus so that people aren't walking around being like, oh, I was told this student at Cyber Studios was in the Navy Yard, and I entered here not knowing that there's a, so it should be, I think there should be, if it is city property, it should be universal consistency. I understand they might have branding on their specific side of it, but it should be part of the master plan of it. Also, there's a diversity of buildings, and I think having color, even, I definitely think we should be colored entrances, but having different colored numbers on buildings is not going to make sense if you have 100 buildings. It's not going to, I think, so having an elegant, and I think what you were saying about the identification, it should be elegant, and then with the street names and other elements, the fact that this is a Navy Yard, it was built in, what, the 18th century, and that we're kind of like ignoring the whole history of what was there before is something that's problematic in the street namings and the way that kind of we are now engaging it just as a simple office park, which if we want to be moving forward, we need to be recognized that on a historic site, there should be something acknowledgement of it. I can say another time.
That's good.
Duration. main, the overall roof plan, like I said before, the two levels connected by a sloping roof, their roof equipment, and then the rest of it is will be occupied with store area. Two elevations showing the east side, a view from the east river side, and then view from the west side from FDR and the Avenue C. And again, a couple elevation views looking at it from the north side of the building and the south side of the building. The main components or materials of the building, the stainless steel metal cladding, we have concrete structure, we have glazing, and seam. Section indicating the spatial arrangement. Ground floor is mostly storage, like I said, and classroom, and then stair, and the structured office space. In terms of what this material would look like when it's built, we've been working with a one of the suppliers that we've been considering, and this is a project that has been completed in Canada, which used the same exact mesh with the same transparency, 50%. And from the inside, you have a pretty decent view of the outside. It acts as not only as a screen and aesthetic element, but also as a shading for glazed areas. The detailing of the metal mesh, the way this works is it is the mesh screen is actually pretty durable, but it's also connected by these connector rods on top and bottom, which is then anchored to the brackets, which is supported by the main structure of the building.
So I had some comments that
yes.
I don't know if you addressed, but so the question about the solar array, which
yes.
is kind of the whole idea about the building,
yes.
obviously, so how it's perceived, I mean, you see it obviously from a, like, you see it from the highway, right?
Yes.
I should
the building lowered a little bit, so
it's so sad that nobody can go up there. Obviously, you lament that as well.
Yes.
So you're kind of left with the situation, obviously, with this stair that's as wide as the stair below. That signifies also the elevation that has the same swoop about this idea you could go up and then you go in to find out you can't get up there.
I think
so. I don't know what to say about that.
Yeah, I mean,
just get a little more
it's a valid point. I think what I would say is the solar array itself, while it's a nice element, but it's not the only element of the solar one's educational purpose. And from what I understand, what they use different mobile tools that can be shown and demonstrated. And then I know that they currently, in their program, they go to different schools. Actually, my son goes to a school in East Village, and Solar One works with his elementary school, and they don't have solar arrays to demonstrate. They just bring tools, or they sometimes demonstrate on an app. So there are many ways to do it. It is nice that it's visible from many directions. And you're right, it's unfortunate that we cannot get up there.
It just seems that's why you made this design.
I mean, you could go to school having a building.
Yeah.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
But I think in terms of how the building is integrated, or the solar array integrated into the building itself, in itself is a demonstration of how this building alone can become an example.
So there's so another question about that.
Yes.
So I saw you from below where I can see how high the panels are mounted, because I know you can work there.
Yes.
So how high can you walk underneath them?
Not quite. It's elevated about 2 feet. So what we've designed right now is we have steel structure that comes out of the roof, and to make sure that there's no damage to the roofing element and waterproofing. And then we have beams that can support a racking system. And even now we're having discussions with experts on how they make it mounted and how efficient they can actually generate energy.
Okay, so then a couple other questions on that. So does the capacity that you're demonstrating on the roof have anything to do with what you're generating in the building?
Yes, actually, we have 58 solar panels, which can generate about 25 kilowatts, which actually can cover the energy consumption of the building. That
okay.
said,
so proportionally
right.
it covers
correct,
something.
Right.
So it does stand for something, but
yes.
you can't see it. And then I was wondering about the storage. We used to have the kayaks, right?
Yes.
So you lost that, which is sad.
Yes.
We all lament that now.
So
you've got this huge storage. What's happening?
Yeah, so
there? What's going on?
Right now,
see it from the, wouldn't be able to see it from the pavement at grade level. So I don't think from an educational point of view, they're going to lose a lot other than the ability to say, yeah, but probably we can see it. But educationally, we do it all the time. There are 100 schools getting solar in New York City out of 1,700 school buildings. And we've been at about 800 schools today. So we do this kind of teaching and an educational programming all the time. So I don't think that should be a concern as much as, for example, the aesthetics or something like that. But the educational part of this thing covers.
Thank you for your work, first of all.
Thank you.
But I do, how many of those 100 schools can students actually see the actual solar panels that are actually working?
Surprisingly, not a lot. Because in order to get them to the roof, the schools face the same problems. And put fencing up around the building and all that kind of stuff. But we are able to do all different kinds of solar applications in the classroom and also in some cases on the student grounds without necessarily being able to get up on the roof.
I guess for us, one of the main selling points of the building was that. And so it's like, and that there aren't other places, that there aren't other places, because the word that we all use is, it would be wonderful, and we think that it should be wonderful. But the cost of not doing it, and thinking long term, actually could be worse. Because if you want to have this as a successful education tool and inspire children and give them access to actual things that are affecting, like it's one thing like, oh look, this is this and this is this. And look, you can see it. No, anymore. This is actually what's powering everything you've seen. So I know that raising money, et cetera, are bigger issues, but because there are other partners that from the city that might be using the space and others that did and made a lot of concessions to the space, I think there could be a strong argument.